Yes, it's 7:05.
All right. So we have a continued notice of intent for 270-0664 76 Longwood Road, map 19, lot 15, Mahoney. It's now opened. Reopen is being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Massachusetts Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant will present proposal. Commission will receive reports from the administrator, any advisors, or other town departments. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. And then the public will be given an opportunity to ask questions, and it should be directed to the chair. Do we have an attendance sheet, Chuck?
Yes.
Put one out.
And I would encourage everyone to sign in. At this time, would the members of the Conservation Commission please introduce themselves, starting on my right?
David Pinnett.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck Tarani, Administrator.
Okay. And the Mahoneys are here. And I believe we did receive a new plan from Jack Sullivan. Chuck, were you in conversations with Chuck, and I mean Jack today?
Yeah, I was. I sent Jack a few emails asking him about the 500 gallons. What did we ask for? 500 gallon dry well, which I thought was mentioned at the last meeting, and that's what was in the minutes. And he told me that the commission, he offered that, but the commission wanted to have a drip trench instead. And I thought that was fine. But I didn't know what the commission's recollection was.
That's what I recall.
Okay, that's good.
So that's how that went. I wanted to make sure that that was fine. And then as I was writing the order, I did notice that other projects in that same area had different mitigation. So they moved no closer, other projects had moved no closer to the riverfront, had increased the buffer zone against the back to have a larger habitat and a larger protected area. And they did do infiltration. They did some plantings also. So those things were not part of this project, although we're closer to the riverfront than the house is right now. So I just wanted to make sure that we have our mitigation correct. And then we need to talk about the granite bounds, because their property line ends right at the fence, and 25 feet from the riverfront would be behind the fence, and 25 feet from that side wetland would, I don't know if that really works for our purposes to have those granite bounds on the side of the yard. So those are the things I want you guys to talk about and get your opinion on what to do about them.
On some of these other projects, what kind of shrub plantings have they been looking at?
Well, the one I looked at was a 10-foot wide buffer that had 70 plants in it. So it was for a bigger project.
68?
Was it? Yes, it was 68.
So, yes, that's next door. So. Yeah, that was a full tear down, I believe. Like that. It was a full tear down and reconstruction. And,
Our mitigation was the removal of the play structure.
We had talked about that, but I thought it was impervious, but it was a pervious surface, so you don't gain anything by doing it.
It was, I think the conclusion we reached, or what we talked about last meeting, was that when you factor in the amount of already impervious surface and grass mm-hmm. under the deck, taking out the bulkhead, et cetera, the actual increase in square footage of impervious surface is relatively small.
187 feet, square feet.
Okay, so
the other project that the applicants talked about had 160-something square feet.
Okay.
Of additional impervious. So that those two lined up.
Okay. And I don't remember exact. I don't remember that we necessarily even drew a conclusion, other than saying we thought there should be some sort of infiltration into the ground.
Which I guess it was Al who was talking about the drip trench.
Yeah.
And I think we agreed that was
probably adequate.
Adequate.
Mm-hmm.
So, drip trench for the new structure.
For
the whole...
For the addition.
It's just for the
addition.
It looks like the side of
some of the new structure.
Yeah.
So I think what we also talked about is where the, over the garage, where they're going up, since there's going to be a new roof line and gutter, connecting that to the drip trench doesn't really cost anything extra and gives a little bit more control over the runoff. And so that's additional mitigation that, you know, I think is beneficial and isn't really a burden. So I'm comfortable with that. So that what comes off the back of the house, over the garage, as well as from the addition going into a drip trench, I think would be fine, where the yard is so flat.
But Chuck, you're saying that on previous projects, we've been looking at shrub placement as a buffer?
Yeah, that's one example that was, I guess, next door that had done some, I guess, a tear down from what I'm hearing, and then increased the amount of buffer strip. So,
buffer strip to the river or buffer strip to the...
To the river.
So in order to accomplish that, you'd have a 10-foot wide buffer of vegetation on the inside of the fence?
No, I just gave an example. I'm just saying someone else in the area was asked for more mitigation than a drip trench that did an addition or a tear down in a new house.
Yep.
So 10-foot wide buffer with 70 plants in it is not what I'm asking
for. No, I understand. Okay. But so that's an example of what somebody else did.
Yeah.
So to I guess just the first one, I think I would be open to want to see, well, it's all fenced. I mean, I guess there's potential for the buffer on the right side, some sort of buffer on the south side. I guess in my mind there's
east. Is it east? No.
Southwest.
Wait, can you point?
Yes, thank you.
Southwest.
Right here.
It seems like there's a lot already in between the line, and granted, you know, maybe this was done in the past for another project, but it just seems like there's already a lot in between the edge of the yard and what's on the bank. You know, there's already a lot,
that's all vegetated.
Yeah.
What
are we going to improve in that sense?
I'm a little confused on the edge of the property. I see the property line, but what's on the, is it all grass on the inside of that property line?
On the, at the very back, it's all grass. On the, I guess as you look at it there, on the right-hand side, all along the property line, it's hostas, there's some hydrangea, there's some other plantings along there. So there's plantings all along the right side, and then there's plantings all around the house, and there's plantings where it says landscape timber retain wall on the left side. There's plantings there, but the rest is grass.
Are we thinking of some plantings in here within that 25-foot area? Is there any kind of a bed right in here, or is this all grass?
Yes, no, so that's a bed. So yeah, so that corner.
In between here, there is plantings here.
What kind of plantings?
So there's a pyrus.
Yeah.
There's a
dogwood.
Dogwood. There's what's the tall one? It's not enough.
then
There's no
all
grass
along
in that.
This,
Everything to the right of the structure is plantings.
Okay, would you consider some more native plantings? Is there room there?
Okay.
Would you just be amenable to something else?
How far would it go? Section or farther down?
On that. As long as it's inside of the first 100 foot, which is this one here.
Okay.
Do you have a preference of this? Is there a
So probably this and all the pretty much all the way in. It's just one strip of hostas along the entirely.
Right.
And then here we have a hydrangea at the very end. Again, it's entirely shady along that way.
I can't remember now. Is that, does the 6 foot high fence come around along that property line as well?
It's not our fence, it's our neighbor's fence.
Okay. What is it? It's a solid 6 foot high?
Yeah,
yes,
it's a stockade.
Fence, yeah.
Yeah.
So anything on your side of it is going to be in the shade pretty much all day?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. Would the rest of the commission consider, I don't know. Five.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's fine. It sounds like it's going to be tough to find locations for them.
Well,
but I mean,
high bush blueberry. You know, I mean, they grow in the wetland, and it's in a shady condition. So, and that's a native.
We have a list on the website. We can just pick off the list.
And I could put one in with the application when we send it to you.
The other item, the granite bounds.
Are there any out? Is that are they? Do they show up on this plan?
No. So this is different from this is completely different. Something we haven't talked about. Typically involved with our notes of intent, we include marking granite bounds to delineate the wetland. We put them 25 feet off.
On the 25 foot.
On the 25 foot
line,
you put granite bounds to mark where the wetland is. So two items. The first one along the riverfront, it's not on their property.
No.
Well, some of it is, right?
25.
Yeah. So, though, that was going to be my next. So the riverfront one, so the A line is, a 25-foot line is not on their property.
Okay.
Oh, right.
The B line, we had some discussion last week about not wanting to even include in the, you know, make note in the notice of intent that 4B may not really actually be in the right location. I guess we didn't really think about how that impacts granite bounds.
What do we do? So with granite bounds on a riverfront, do we put those at 100 feet?
No. You're still 25? Looking at the wetland area because it's no disturbance.
Right. Okay.
So it looks like there's one you could put like right here.
It might be a little confusing, but would you consider just putting the plaques on the fence low enough, you know, so it doesn't, I mean, put it anywhere you want, but maybe a foot or two off the ground?
It's not their fence either.
The back fence is yours, right?
The back fence.
The back fence. That runs parallel to the Abajona.
So where does the fence lie relative to the 25 foot from the riverfront?
It's shown on the plan. It's the...
This is the stockade fence.
Yeah.
And so the bank is right here.
Right. So we don't have a 25-foot line, right?
Mm-mm, no. And it's, let me see. 25 feet.
This is where going paperless gets hard. Well, you're good. Look at that.
Oh, I've done this so many years. You're still way out. You're past the property line, Chuck. the 25 feet off, even off the bank?
What do you mean past it? You're in the yard, or you're not even in the yard yet?
You're not in the yard, you're off the property.
Yeah, no, that's what I said. So typically with a notice of intent, we put in granite bounds, but that's, a compromise would be to put it on the fence. I think it's, or not at all. I mean, it's up to the commission.
It'd be a little bit beyond the 25 feet.
I mean, the land behind is owned by the town.
I don't have a problem putting it on the fence if other people are amenable to that. It's a little bit beyond the 25 feet.
I think it's fine.
So where would we put it? Sorry, we'll explain in a second. Where would we put it on the fence?
I think you could put it
two locations
on the posts. Well, one at either corner and one in the center, so three locations. I guess we're going to leave the side fence alone because it doesn't belong to them.
Right,
that would be fine.
It just indicates that there is resource area in the vicinity. We usually keep it on the 25 feet, which is the no vegetation disturbance line, but it's a little bit further in, but it's not your property and it's town property, so you know, for all intents and purposes, no cutting's going to happen there, so it's a little bit more protective of the resource area.
And is it just something that's just drilled into the post, or?
There are 10 signs, 4 inches by 4 inches, and it's like a picture of an owl, and it says Reading Resource Area on it. It looks pretty nice. I mean, it's pretty flat.
Why is it an owl? Why isn't it a turtle?
Because we have 1,500 of them, and when they're gone,
we'll
change it.
Come up with a new design.
And so you can get those from Chuck?
I'll... Is that what you want?
I think we want it on your
side,
the inside of the fence.
Yeah.
So yeah, so that way.
From our side, they see that.
Right.
Correct. So
right.
That way, anybody that you know, essentially, anybody that looks at this area, they can see a marker here, a marker in this area.
And if
you ever
sold, they would know that there's a resource area.
Resource area behind there.
The marker would be here, here, and here, right? Along the fence, our fence.
I don't know. Is that what?
Just up in the southwest
corner.
Yeah,
is it just the southwest corner? That's what I was thinking, just the
southwest
corner.
Oh, just one here?
Are you?
And that dotted, the first dotted line inside that corner.
That one there.
Somewhere on a post around here? See this line right here?
Yeah.
Now we're talking about two different
things. They don't own the fence on that side.
So we own the fence starting from here. So this corner going across.
One, two, three.
Okay.
Somewhere in that area.
All right.
And what ends up happening with those is there's a pre-activity meeting, and when I go out to the project, we'll just discuss where they're going to go. So. So when you have your order of conditions, the first thing you would need to do is put in your erosion control, and then there's a whole list of things to do, including recording the order of conditions. But when all that's ready, I go out, check the erosion control, you know, there's a check off, but the sign, the DEP signs up, the erosion control's in properly, and then also there's a section to discuss where the granite bounds are going, but in your case, we're just going to discuss where these plaques are going to go. And that happens, and that's a necessary process, because after that happens, your builder can pull his building permit, or he can pick it up. The paperwork can be in, so it's usually like a day before you get your building permit.
So we agreed. I'm just trying to keep up with you on the minutes. So required to install 3 bound marker plaques along the back fence.
Yes.
And then we've got a. Decide for sure on what we're going to do for infiltration.
We're also going to put one on the southwest corner on the 25-foot line coming up towards the front of the house.
It's not their fence.
Oh.
so.
Okay.
I thought we had agreed on the drip trench.
Everyone's okay with the drip trench?
Yeah.
And that we were looking at
Five.
Five native trees or shrubs along the southeast section.
Southwest section.
Southwest, yep, yep, southwest.
Same corner.
So Chuck, you have an order of conditions, but we haven't reviewed it.
Haven't reviewed it, and what we just talked about is not in it.
Okay.
So.
So do we make a motion to continue? What can we can approve what we've discussed tonight, I suppose.
You can close, but you can't issue.
Okay, a question for you though. If we close, we can't discuss the order of conditions?
The commission can discuss the anything they want, but they can't get any more input from the applicant.
Oh, okay. All right.
Well, the applicant can't give any more input.
Okay.
You can.
Okay.
I don't think you can ask questions or anything like that, but
yeah,
it's you can talk amongst yourselves.
It's no longer open.
Yes. Closing the meeting.
Does that give them the opportunity to review the order conditions and make any discuss any changes?
It really doesn't.
It doesn't give them the opportunity once you close it.
Yeah.
Okay.
What's in the order of conditions
right now? It just describes the work you're doing and certain milestones where you have to contact the commission to come out and look at like the drip trench and make sure that that's done correctly and the size of the additions. But what's not in it is the infiltration and the plaques and
five plans.
So yeah, so
but
typically what's included in that order of conditions is just as Chuck said, you know, when to contact him, when the things need to start, and then really kind of goes over everything we discussed here so that when we go to close this, we can look back and say, all right, were all the things that we asked for fulfilled?
So if you're comfortable with our closing this, I mean, we could go ahead and do that.
Yeah, so we've agreed drip trench in those two locations.
Which are reflected on the plan.
On the plan,
yes.
On the plan, exactly. The five native plants in the corner. The sign, the tree signs.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. That's all.
Okay.
Stuff.
Do I hear a motion?
Make a motion to close meeting on 270-0664.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, 400. Okay.
So what's the next steps?
At the next meeting, we'll sign the order of conditions. I'll actually send a copy to Jack and make sure that that works. And then I'll send it out to you, and there's a 10-day appeal period, and after that, you're okay to go with your project.
Do you need to be present?
You don't need to come to the next meeting.
Okay.
So when Jack reviews it, if he has any questions, he'll get back to me. I'll send you a copy too, and if you have any questions, you can get back to me. But the meeting is closed, so it's a nice project, but it's really not that complicated, so there's probably not going to be anything that you're surprised at.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good evening.
Okay.
Yes,
what?
We didn't ask for comment.
Oh, I'm remiss.
Do you,
right. I think you should fire me. What?
I was just wondering if you wanted to ask the applicants on this next timed issue, they'd like to allow us to take on this minor plan change for us.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is Cross Street.
Cross Street.
We got some information today on 56 Cross Street.
Talking about right
here. Yeah.
Yep.
So we had originally, should I tell you what's going on?
Yes, please.
Sorry, before you said, just so I have an, was this originally a, an RDA, an NOI,
It was notice of intent.
Notice of intent, okay.
So I guess from what I said, it was all approved and everything, but we were going to conservation, I mean, sorry, for variance because we were just over the setback here on the corner of the building. So what we didn't, we ended up withdrawing that application, notching this back in. So it did come all the ways here, we just notched this back in here to meet the setback guidelines, that's all.
So it was originally squared off?
It was originally squared off and we just had to make this little jog in here.
The setback you're talking about is not associated with that?
It has to do with, it was zoning.
Nothing to do with it, that was with the building department. We were within the boundaries of the, side yard setback.
Side yard setback.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We were 15 feet, where we were at like 13.9.
Yeah.
So they, we just withdrew it and we just notched this into meet their setback rules. We just made it a little bit smaller.
Okay.
Considering this is on the other side of the resource area.
Yeah, so the only thing we had here was the drip trench here. So I don't know how it fits into this area now, but I did ask if that is still going in and
it's
for the dry.
That's still the plan and
okay.
We're just gonna tie the gutters in to that, like we had all talked about.
I would, anybody have any issues?
Nope.
Anybody in the public have any issues with this?
I make a motion to approve minor plan change for 56 Cross Street.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, guys.
Is that Dave that's second?
Yes.
Thank you.
So Chuck, we just.
No, I just send you out a letter saying that at this meeting we accepted it. That's all you get. No.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You too.
Why don't you wait until that letter, you can record that letter with the, yeah.
Okay, perfect, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, we have, it's after 7:10 and there's an enforcement order for 218 Salem Street, map 23, lot 90, Yonjin. Did I say that correctly?
That's actually my last name, his last name.
Okay. And,
And I'm Tom Hughes with Hughes Environmental Consulting. Here on behalf of Linda and Shannon.
Yes.
So I've come into the project after your last meeting. I understand you guys are, several of you have been out to the site.
Correct.
Seen the site. As I think you're aware, I think they're, the purpose, and let me erase the
red line things, yeah.
So the obviously there was a misunderstanding and they were thinking that they could go to, you know, to the edge of the, what looks like an old graded area to create some lawn, a young couple just moving into a house. And obviously they were wrong in their assumption. But what I was looking at is if there was a way to restore the area, improve the buffer value, and still give them an area where they can have usable lawn. Because the way the house was before, there was only a very narrow strip of lawn right around the structure, kind of in this area. I think a little bit kind of up in here. And the rest appears to have been overrun with invasive species. You can see Japanese knotweed coming up. If you look at the vegetation that is in the surrounding untouched areas, it's full of Asiatic bittersweet, buckthorn, and there's Japanese barberry.
Poison ivy.
Poison ivy. It is a native, but
yes, it is.
But it's a problematic.
When it invades your skin.
So things like the Asiatic bittersweet will use native trees as trellises and
mm-hmm.
we'll pull them down over time. The buckthorn have allelopathic tendencies, which means they essentially have chemicals that they put into the ground that acts almost like Roundup and stops native plants.
Could you say that word again?
Allelopathic.
I love it.
Some of the other invasives are thought to have that too. The leaves of Norway maples.
Norway, yeah.
that not only do they come out and shade everything out early because they leaf out before anything else and the leaves are bigger and the canopy's denser, so they shade everything out, but it, there are some studies that show that compost made from Norway leaves does not grow things as well as other compost. So there's some indication that they do that as well. So it was an impaired buffer that was impacted here. In taking a look at everything, I went through old minutes, the order of conditions, and in understanding the site, it looks like when they constructed the two homes, this was out of a large parcel. There's a vernal pool over here. This is the neighbor's house. And the focus is a little off here, but basically there are bounds that represent a conservation restriction area. On the parcel closer to the vernal pool, the conservation restriction bounds protected a wider vegetation strip to be untouched, as well as the wetland area and the vernal pool. On this property, the conservation restriction shot back and then goes kind of much closer to the wetland line that was flagged originally as part of the permit. And the minutes and everything are not 100% clear on why that is, but it appears that it was a little bit of a compromise because of the conservation restriction. You know, 4 acres of land, getting a tiny house and all that kind of stuff. What I looked at is there a compromise? I mean, this, I approximated where a 25-foot no disturb natural zone of vegetation would be based on the old wetland line. I don't have the LEC flags that were placed before I was brought in on the plan. I do have this note, LEC 3. There's a bound that has an LEC flag wrapped around it. My just very quick look at the flags, there's like flag 1 is somewhere over here, flag 2 is somewhere here, and flag 3 here, is that those flags look very high to me. The vegetation is sort of in the FAC range, but there doesn't appear to be hydrology, and I hazard a guess if I put my auger in the ground, I'm not going to see hydric soils. I don't know that it's as far out as the original wetland line, but I think the LEC flags in this area are a little too high.
Can you show me the flags, the LEC flags?
So I only have one LEC flag shown. This is not to scale. I actually taped everything off the LEC flags thinking there might be a plan showing those, and there isn't. But there's a bound right here, and that's where LEC flag 3 is. It's actually wrapped around that bound. So that one I can say for certain I've got that right. So this is the old wetland line. So about 8 feet landward of the old wetland line is where they put the flag. And it's more at the top of the slope than at the bottom of the slope.
It seemed like where that the conservation restriction was where the LEC flags were over in this area. Did you see them?
I saw them, and I didn't, you know, I didn't get down in there and auger and really look at them. The ones that were obvious to me that at least my gut is they're high. Now, I might get in there and look at soils, and I might say, oh, wow, no, they're right on. But I think they're a little bit high. What I drew on here is just based on what I do have, which is the old flags. So this is what a 25 zone would look like off the old flags. Assuming the LEC flags are closer, it would be closer. It would be up into the area where the lawn already was.
Right.
But what I was looking at is I actually measured this off the LEC flags with the idea of providing an additional 7 feet of buffer from like flag one, actually eight feet on one, 7 on 2, 5 on flag 3, and then start increasing them going around to finally meet a 25 foot when we get on the side. So kind of as a compromise, allowing some lawn to go in here, they would be within 25 feet of the wetland area, but in exchange for that, within an area, and again, this is approximate, I would actually want to go out and look where the invasives are and adjust this so it captured the bulk of the invasives in that area. These guys would control and remove the bittersweet, the buckthorn, the Japanese barberry, all of the invasives, and plant natives. So we would make the wetland resource area more intact that way, and we will provide a more functional buffer, even if it's a narrower in some spots, by providing a much healthier buffer.
Are you also amenable to removing that structure that seems to be sitting further out there?
Which is a structure?
I think that needs to go.
The retaining wall that they just put in.
So what would happen is the retaining wall that was placed out here would all be removed.
Okay.
Up closer to the house, kind of right behind where the deck is,
mm-hmm.
wrapping around more or less where the old wall was, we would put a slightly shorter wall. I think the problem with that wall was it was placed in there at a time when this was part of the floodplain. It's no longer part of the floodplain. It's no longer part of the 100-year flood. And so it was used to cut grading short, so there wasn't as much fill in the floodplain.
But I thought they put the floodplain replication in that hatched area.
There was floodplain replication. There are minutes that show that that was done, and the seeding of it was signed off on by the commission back in 99.
Mm-hmm.
But in 99, this was mapped by FEMA as part of the floodplain. The floodplain maps have since been revised, and it's no longer in the floodplain. So fill in this area is not a concern in terms of volume. So what they did, in order to minimize how much digging they had to do here, they didn't grade off from the house. They graded off a little bit, just enough to keep the foundation buried, and then they put in a VersaLock wall to minimize how much fill was going. We don't need to have a 4-foot wall here, so the idea would be maybe go down about 2 feet with it and then taper off towards the conservation restriction area, basically taper off to where that wall was placed, right? We would remove that, taper off with good organic loam, something that will vegetate well, plant it with natives, so we would restore a fully intact vegetation zone here. We'd even go a little bit beyond 25 in this little section here. And then as we kind of turn the corner, we would essentially give a backyard to the house and then just have a narrower area, but this would be invasives removed, and we would fill in to make sure that there were dense native plantings in there. We could include some saplings, we could include shrubs, things like high bush blueberry, viburnums, hazelnut, there's a number of nice natives that would do well. So we would provide a varying width zone of natural vegetation. We would then mark that appropriately with bounds. We could mark it with bounds here, and here, so that there's no doubt on what's happening. So that would be beyond the conservation restriction area, but it would expand sort of what is protected beyond the conservation restriction by clearly labeling that that's an area not to be touched, and it would give them kind of this area behind the house as a backyard. This blue area here, we would also extend that short retaining wall. It might get even shorter as you come around back, but just to have it so that you come out onto flat and you can step down to at least something that's relatively flat. It's still gonna have a pitch going out, but at least it will be a livable, mowable. If they have a child, they could set up a swing set back there, and just kind of makes it a more livable house. The other thing, if we go forward with that concept, we'd also, in this area above the wall and next to the deck, wanna put an at-grade patio, just something. And it could be a fairly low impact patio, but just something at grade up near the house. But the reason I'm here is we wanted to fill you guys out for just this conceptually. We can talk about distances and how wide and what plants and how we control invasives and really come up, flesh out the details. But conceptually, whether this is something the commission is open to. And if it is, what I'd like to ask, and I know you've done a site visit, but is that you do another site visit and we actually walk and look at what this would mean physically on the ground and just get feedback from the commission before we go forward and invest a lot of time into detailing everything out.
that's kind of where I'm thinking, and what I'm trying to grasp is you really haven't looked at the wetland to, you know, refute the LEC line.
Yeah, and I would do
and
that
so,
before a site visit.
So
yeah.
We don't really know what, you know, what we're talking about as far as, you know, square footages. So what I'd kind of like to know is, okay, so you have an established line, okay?
Right.
And then you come around and you've got that 25 feet of no disturbance. How much of that now, under existing conditions, are you asking to use, and then what are you giving in, you know, what's the square footage that you are
right
giving?
and we would go through and calculate that, and I need to go out to the site. I need to look at the LEC flags with a little more detail and see whether or not I believe any need to be adjusted. I would hang those. If you set a site visit, I'll make sure that field work is done before you come out.
I need to ask the other commission members,
yeah,
how they feel about this.
I'd be open. I think there's also, you know, as I look at this and I realize you're putting together a rough plan.
Yeah.
You know, as I look at this, this area here, that wouldn't necessarily be proposed to be.
We might actually. I mean, that's up for discussion whether we expand. What I was trying to do, I did a real quick draft. I sent it off to Chuck. Chuck said, well, you know, where's the 25? And we talked about at least making sure that we captured the 25 here. But we can, I mean, this side is far less useful, you know, unless they do what they did, the wall all the way to the edge, which clearly we have to put something back and we have to provide some value. It seems like this is the place to really do that. That's closer to the brook. You know, and it's an area which is riddled with invasives, so it's an area that I think we can really add value to. And we could talk about extending this up, you know, so that essentially they have the lawn above the wall, and then below that.
Tom, what's in the area that looks like the boot of the floodplain replication area?
This is vegetated, and realistically, we would just kind of look to take wherever the existing vegetation area up this way. There's a fairly large tree somewhere in this area, and it's covered with vines. It's covered with poison ivy and bittersweet.
Is it a mature,
it's
large
a huge,
tree?
Very,
huge.
Very large. And it was.
Why did they leave that?
The floodplain, the notes about the floodplain, where they were going to excavate for the floodplain, but they were going to have varying depths in order to preserve the root system.
It's a gigantic tree.
Huh.
It is huge, and it will come down not too long from now if the bittersweet is not controlled. And frankly, the poison ivy is doing a number on it too.
Right, poison ivy does, yeah.
So I mean, I think what I'd like to do is visit the site with the commission, and we can talk about, you know, how we can best add value to the buffer, mitigate for things as part of restoring everything, but still at least give them some area that's usable.
I'm going back to that floodplain. If it's no longer floodplain, could you use that? Is it wetland?
Well, that's just as much inside 25, and my guess is if they excavated it down, the wetlands probably have expanded in here.
Okay, all right.
I mean,
it's pretty much undisturbed.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing this does a nice job of doing is buffering everything here from the road.
Yeah.
So I think that removing a little bit of buffer, you know, especially since it was riddled with invasives, from the impact of a single family home, as opposed to removing buffer that's kind of blocking everything from the road, I think my preference would be to remove from the house, you know, the house disturbance.
Tom, I've got a couple of questions. So
yeah.
There's a line around both houses, a dark dotted line. Is
yeah.
that the property line?
This was the surveyed Haydale location.
Okay, so I can ignore that. So what's the green line?
The green line was where I was proposing we make an edge of lawn, a new edge of lawn.
Okay, all right.
So, and then this pink area was just a real approximation of where the invasives are.
Okay.
And within this is some disturbed area, but all of these areas, basically, this would be fully restored to a native buffer.
I get that. So the pink dotted line, what's that?
That's an approximation of 25 off the original delineated.
Okay, all right, thank you. So I would concur that anything to the left of the house as you're standing on the street, the more you can compromise there to allow that to be restored as wetland is the place you want to do it. And the trade-off is you give up a little bit at the back. I'm kind of uncomfortable about the patio, given, you know, unless it's some kind of pervious surface.
Well, we could, yeah. And I think that's why a site visit would be important, because it's on the, so the house was built and is essentially a shelf right off the house. And it would be within that shelf, be right up against the house. So I'd like to kind of show you where that would be, and we could talk about it being pervious pavers, or, you know, I've done patios with clamshell that actually harden up nicely but are still pervious. There's things we can, and I can talk to the client about, you know, what kind of material they're willing to use there. We can do a very low impact.
Okay. And last question I had is, and I don't know if there's a right or wrong answer for this, but beyond the pink shaded area where you would do the invasive removal, is it all invasives beyond that that is going
to
grow back?
It tends to trend into natives from what I can see eyeballing. I did not get down in there and transfer the poison ivy and, you know, look at it.
I mean, my worry is you fix all that and, you know, a year later.
So the invasives we're talking about, the buckthorn and the bittersweet, tend to be, even though bittersweet, or the buckthorn is listed as a wetland plant, they tend to be boundary and buffer. So sometimes they're a little bit in. Bittersweet will grow from the buffer into the wetland, but they generally don't grow in wet areas. So the idea is, I go over the, this is the one area we'll need to look at. If this is truly not wetland, I think LEC flagged kind of across here, but if this is not wetland, there may be invasives in here. So we would add that.
I think my recollection is that we saw skunk cabbage pretty close to those concrete bounds.
Right.
For the conservation area.
Yeah.
And that the original line was farther from the house than you would put it today.
Right. No, I don't disagree that I don't think it's here.
Yeah.
I just do think that the LEC was a little bit, you know, I think a bound was there and there's nothing else to hang a flag on, and it might actually belong with a stake 3 feet beyond that. And I think we're talking about an area where a couple feet might make a difference. So I do want to take a look at that. You know, LECs, they're good wetland scientists. They do, you know, they do delineate wetlands on a regular basis. I'm not trying to tear their line apart, but I think it might need some adjustment. And it may be that after I put an auger in the ground, I say, oh no, this thing's fine. But what I did do when I approximated this, I actually based it off their flags. And Menendra and I taped off each flag, and I have my notes on, you know, we basically, like I said, I think it was 8, 7, 5, and then we started going up again, and then we eventually got to 25 as we kind of made the corner. So the idea was to kind of have an increasing vegetation area as you go around the corner. Once we do a site visit, I can actually tape off of, you know, we put stakes in the ground on where we all agree it's reasonable, and then I can tape off of house corners and off of the bounds and actually fairly accurately represent on this. To me, that's the most cost-effective way of doing it. If the commission wants it to be surveyed, then we'll have to get a surveyor to come in and do that. But we can fairly accurately represent things just by taping off several points.
Do you have an approximation where the the line of disturbance currently is on that?
It's sort of in this.
Bounds?
No,
I would say somewhere about like here,
where it was moved.
I don't have a great sense because I couldn't see these bounds here on where we are in relation to the bounds, but I think it kind of cuts through here.
You're talking about
the
retaining
interlock while it was moved.
Yeah,
that was what was this black line
right
here, and that would all be removed. And we could actually, I mean, I could represent the same way. I could tape off known areas and put an approximate location of where that had been on the old plan, I could kind of give you a representation of what the violation was by taping things off. It'd be, you know,
mm-hmm.
it'd be a little bit of a cartoon. It would not be a survey plan, but it would be fairly accurate. And then I could do another plan where we mark up like this, you know, exactly what we're proposing, and then we would give you a detailed plant list, plant densities, methodologies for removing the invasives and controlling the invasives, and give you, you know, give you a better sense of how the wall would work. It probably doesn't have to come this far. It probably would start somewhere in here. Apparently the wall was never really built all the way out the way it was shown on the plan. So we would look at all that, and we'd just like to make sure that we're not going down a road that the commission is unwilling to consider, because it's an awful lot of work to put this together, and to do it right. And then, just as we did on other cases like the one of Van Norden, where we, I don't know if any of you guys were on the commission for that, but we had a very similar thing. In that case, the fill went all the way into the wetland, and we were able to restore it, and the commission required me to be there on and off during the work to make sure that everything was done according to the plan we put up with. And it, I mean, I think it was a success. I think in that case, the original wetland line was too conservative. But we did get down to the original O layer, and I think it, I mean,
mm-hmm.
Chuck's seen it recently with the shed.
So did the commission.
Yeah,
so
you guys have seen that site. We restored
with
wetlands.
With the shed,
the
with Pradeep?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So are you advancing that you want to relocate the LEC wetlands line?
Well, I think
I'm
thinking that this one in particular belongs about 3 feet or 4 feet down. It's sitting right next to a Japanese barberry, and Japanese barberry is typically not on the boundary. The other plants around are sort of invasive fac and things that don't jump out at me, scream out that I'm wetland. They don't scream out I'm upland, so I'd want to look at soils. But it's at the top of a slope, so it doesn't really seem that it would have the hydrology that you would need. But then again, there are dry wells that were installed as part of the project in here, and it could be that once I look at the soils that I end up agreeing with LEC.
Because one of the things I'm looking at here in the upper left-hand corner, we have that red arrow where it has invasive removal.
Right.
I just recall the flags, the orange flags that are in there to be closer to those concrete bounds area.
They are.
And feeling like they were correct. And feeling like they were probably correct.
Yeah, because it was right in the middle of, you know,
yeah,
whole field of skunk cabbage in there. So
I saw the flags over here, and I didn't have the same reaction that I did to the flags.
Okay.
You know, again, I haven't gone and actually augered around.
So I think what you have, you know, my personal, I think what you have is a good idea. You know, I'm certainly amenable. I would like to see where the wetland is and get out there and do a site visit with you. I think that we can, you know, kind of get a better feel for those other items. But I know at least I'm amenable to the concept.
So I have a couple more questions.
Yeah.
You both talked about the snakes under the steps. Is it, so to the left of the stairs to the top of the old retaining wall, is that lawn today?
Which one? I'm sorry.
So the area between your front steps and the original retaining wall?
Yes.
Oh,
yeah.
Right in here.
Yeah, there's lots of little slope over there.
But it's lawn. You know, you can mow it.
Kind of.
All right. The only piece on all of this that kind of, I mean, I feel like we're it's a borderline situation. And particularly the triangle in the upper left-hand corner of this, of the lawn, between the green line and the hay bales. You know, so many lines
here
on there. That triangle kind of, that gives me a little bit of heartburn.
Well, we can, again, this is sort of what I was trying to do is more or less line up so that the back of the house out and over, so we could probably trim that a little bit. Again, what I was trying to do was I put this into Adobe and I just quickly marked it up to get a concept on paper. So I'm not, today,
fine.
I'm not looking for you to say that point is perfect.
Okay.
It's,
I mean, I think that's,
the idea is we're not approving a plan.
No, I get it.
We're talking about it and seeing if it makes any kind of sense.
Yeah.
Or if we're adamantly opposed to it, but I don't feel adamantly opposed to it.
No,
I think there are a lot of questions that this new line, you know, came up, you know, and it's, whoa, that, you know, it was a lot closer than what was originally flagged.
Yeah, and that may be the hydrology of the stream may have changed.
Could have happened, yeah.
It may be as a result of the dry wells from the house, or it could have just been back in the day when it was flagged. It may not have been flagged all that well, although I think this was actually before Fran. Because the notes talked about a male administrator, 98, 99. Fran Fink, her lines that she reviewed generally tend to be upland lines. My experience is when I've looked at lines that were reviewed under, they were sometimes 10 or 15 feet above where a real upland line was. I don't know, though, the prior administrator and how that went, but it may have been that, you know.
I'm okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I definitely think everything to the left of the house, basically to the old retaining wall, should be restored to wetland.
Don Nadeau?
Well, to buffer.
He was here.
Right.
Yeah.
Tom, was it Don Nadeau?
It didn't
had
say,
to have been.
You know, it was funny because all it would reference is the administrator, and he said, but it doesn't have his name.
It's the only one I can think of. He was between Beth McKillop, that crew, and then he was after. That was probably put somewhere around there.
So when can we do a site visit?
So I just have a couple questions.
Ten.
So I was wondering what the distance from the house to the 25-foot line was in the back, your estimate.
Let's see.
So that
25,
deck is like 12
right,
feet.
Right, that's 25, and the house out, I would say it's less than 25. It's in the 22 to 20 range, probably 20 in that area.
From the 25-foot line.
From the 25 of the old flags.
Yeah.
Now, ultimately, once we have flags, if the LEC flags or even as adjusted are set, I'll have to tape those off and put them on a plan so I can give you a reasonable representation of where it is. I would guess, you know, LEC, so if that's where it is based on the old one, and if the LEC flag is there, it's basically, you know, where the deck is, and it's basically where it starts to go down.
Can I just ask something?
No,
can
I finish?
Forward? Sure.
Well, unless it's part of what we just talked about.
Is when you're doing this, if you're going to remark that,
yeah,
at the same time before we go and do a site visit, that you have something in there that demarcates where you feel the wetland line is, and then actually give the 25-foot line offset from that marked.
Yeah,
so
I'll tape it and paint it on the ground.
So when we go out and visit, that there's something that's, we have six balls in the air here. It's an amorphous blob that we're talking about. So.
Yeah,
I'd like to have something that's a little bit more concrete that we're talking about. I think you're going in the right direction, but it's just.
Yeah, no, I was only.
Wow.
These guys called me, you know, about a week and a half ago, and I was unable to meet with them until Thursday. So I met with them, just very quickly came up with this concept, and absolutely, I agree. There's a lot more detail we need to provide, and we'll do that.
I've got another thing, but Chuck wanted to say something.
Yeah, I just wanted to finish up. So I would like to urge you and warn the commission not to approve any new structure closer than 35 feet. So Tom, if you could come up with it, if that retaining wall is beyond 35 feet, that's great.
Okay.
If it's not, you should really come up with something else, because we really haven't gone over that in this town yet. And I think it's important for all of our projects not to have structures within 35
feet. No, that's fair enough. Do you consider a patio structure?
We do, but we don't consider shelves a structure. So if you do your little shell thing,
okay,
it
and
work out.
Have you allowed structures within 35 when there's been a pre-existing structure within 35? In other words, we have an existing deck right here. If we do a patio that is no closer than the existing structure, is that setting a dangerous precedent, or is that something?
No, if there's something there and you're going to remove the deck and put down the patio, Is that what you're gonna do? Is you're going
no,
underneath?
No, I was thinking it would be next to
oh,
it,
next
but
to
it would
it?
Be no.
no
closer.
Yeah, that's why I have a problem with it. I just
no.
Okay.
You
know,
we
no, so we'll tape it all off. We'll see where
yeah.
it all lays.
We haven't
and
done
we,
that.
And if we have to,
but I'm sure
know.
That's 30 more than 35 feet away where the deck is. I'm just not. I'm concerned about where the retaining wall is.
You know, based on the LEC flag, it's pretty close. I think this is
what
this
wall
is what
was already there. The previous one, this
to
this,
here.
Yeah, that
right.
wall was already there.
It was far as here, and we were talking.
Yeah, it was
about,
tapering off a little bit on that side.
But I see what you're saying. Basically, what we could do is we could just change this to grading. But I was trying to give them a terrace effect as opposed to.
Well, you can do the wall where it exists now, but if you're not 35 feet away, you can't do it.
Can't add to
where
it.
You want.
Right. So let's sort all that out. I understand
yeah.
that, and
yeah,
we will adjust the plan accordingly.
Because I think if we're going to be going into the Z and V with native plants and some compromise on grass, that's more palatable to the commission and to our regulations. But right now we're looking at a variance for the Z and V and a variance for structures, and no, I don't remember two of them coming up in the Conservation Commission since I've been here. So
we will
make
we'll
sure.
avoid a variance for the structure, and the other thing we'll offer in the lawn will be I can talk to these guys, but we could look at things like a Pearl's Premium, a native fescue type of lawn.
Mm-hmm.
It looks, behaves, acts just like lawn grass, but it's a native fescue and it hardly needs watering. It develops a deep root system, and it will actually. Provide more value than a typical lawn. So
sounds great.
So one other thing, there are two trees in the left-hand corner, upper left-hand corner. One of them is dead.
Okay.
Big dead tree. Yeah. And then directly to the left of that is a big tree that's leaning, probably 2 foot diameter.
Yeah. Okay.
We talked about that. Well, we're in there. Tramping around, we ought to, you know, if you could, we ought to just incorporate that into the plan if we're going to.
The dead tree, yeah.
and making sure that the other one, maybe we just need to take another look at it, make sure we feel like it's safe if it's, we get the buck.
See which direction it's leaning.
Yeah, but it doesn't look like it's leaning towards.
I don't think we're deciding if it's safe or not.
Well, I know.
I don't think we're deciding if it's safe or not.
I know, but just.
We'll look at that, and if they need to come down, we can propose, you
yes,
know,
especially
to
it's
put.
It's fine right now in the wintertime when there's a snow, it's like.
I just suggested because before you plant the grass, if you
yeah.
need to remove that dead tree, then
right.
that
it's
ought to be factored
right.
into what you're doing.
When it's taller, a lot taller than the house,
yeah.
means that's going to be a lot of the house.
And then when we go out there, I think it would be nice to know what the project's going to be because I just remembered there's probably going to be a fence at the edge of this lawn.
Well, it would be nice to use something to mark the edge, maybe a little more obvious than bounds. We had talked, they do have a desire to put a fence in to try to keep larger wildlife out. I think it would probably, we would want to do some type of an open fence, not a solid panel so we don't shade the buffer area, and so that they can see if invasives start to come back, because they'll be committed to maintaining and removing invasives. So we would come up with something like that, and it would serve the purpose of marking the new limit of vegetation as well.
Okay.
I don't have any other questions. Thank you. So. You need us to come visit.
Yeah, and the earlier the better. If we could get a visit in soon enough, we can probably put things together for your next meeting and keep progress moving forward.
Our next meeting would be in 2 weeks. Are you proposing we come out a site visit? When we typically have that on a Sunday morning or Tuesday?
Okay.
Or are you thinking of something sooner?
I know I talked to Chuck, and he would like it to be on a weekday, I think, because he was talking about wanting to be there. Sooner would be best for my client. But, you know, Sunday or Tuesday, if you want to do next Tuesday, that...
So our next, let's start with our next site visits and work our way back inside of that. Our next site visit would be either August 7th or August 9th. August 9th is a Tuesday.
Okay.
That's not next Tuesday, but the following Tuesday.
I can do either one of those.
If you can get something earlier in the week, you know, you could propose that, and the commissioners that can make it could go. I'd like to have at least four of us there, I think.
And I'd like to be there, and I'm out until the 4th of August. That's a Thursday.
And you tell us, I mean, maybe you can get a plan prepared. It seems like a short timeline to get something prepared and get us out there by...
Well, part of this is I'd like to have the site visit. I mean, I will do the wetland delineation work and get stuff marked on the ground in terms of where the 25 is. But I think before I prepare a plan, I think if we're all out there and you guys say, oh, we couldn't live with it this far, then I'll make my plan based on that kind of reaction and sort of what we all agree to. But I'll definitely get, you know...
Are we treading on open meeting rules when we do something like that?
I can post if four people show up. I can post it.
Because it's one thing to all agree to go out there on the same day. It's another thing to give you feedback on your plan on that day at that time.
Yeah, you can't deliberate. You can give reactions, but you can't deliberate without posting. It is exempt from open meeting otherwise. Or you can give me feedback through Chuck.
But I could post it.
That would probably be helpful.
And I could take minutes.
When are we talking about this?
Well, you're not back till the 4th. I mean, I think
Which
I
is
agree
Thursday.
It would be. I know you guys are anxious to move this forward, but I think it's most helpful if we have as many of the commissioners.
You're not back, and so the 4th is available?
It's not for me. I'm going to be out of
only
state.
In the evening it would be. It wouldn't be in the afternoon.
Well, what day is the 4th?
It's a Thursday.
Okay. What about...
It's right behind you.
What about Friday?
He's not here on a Friday.
Okay. I mean, I could do Thursday evening. That's kind of a horrible thing to ask for you to come back for vacation and go right out on a site visit, though. And you're not available.
I'm in North Carolina.
So when are you back?
It's just a go down Wednesday, come back Thursday.
So, Chuck, if you want to be there, how about we do the 7th, the Tuesday? Or then the 9th, the Tuesday?
Morning.
Your meeting's the 10th?
Yeah.
Correct.
How would you guys feel if I emailed Chuck a plan like middle of the day the following day?
That's fine.
Is that okay?
That's fine. I think that's fine. Come in just like we did with this one. We'll put it up on the board and we'll have the discussion. If there's any additional changes, you know, we can always talk about them.
Right,
but
okay.
At that point, we've at least gotten out to the site. We've kind of given some impressions, some indications of what we, how we feel. And so then that way at that next meeting, the 10th, we can sit and have this discussion again.
Do you want that meeting on the 9th posted so you can discuss?
I guess I would leave that up to you.
I don't know that we need to do a ton of deliberating there. I think, to your point, we can...
Give indications. Nothing's going to be decided until the 10th.
So you're going to have a wetland line?
I'm going to review the LEC wetland line. And if I feel it needs an adjustment, I'll leave the LEC flag, but I'll put up my own. And I'll write some notes on why I think it needs to be adjusted. And when you guys come out, I'll go through that with you.
Yeah, and then...
So will we be able to figure out where we are with the 25 feet? No disturbance.
Yeah, I will tape off from the line that I believe is accurate. And I can always, we'll know how far off that is from the LEC flag if I move anything. So we'll just be able to say, okay, well, it's actually another 3 feet. You know, so we can...
Sure.
Things will be marked on the ground. The flags will be updated. I think it's safe if you post it. It doesn't harm anything if you post it. It's up to you guys. Just so nobody accuses anybody of having any discussions. But I think you don't have to. It's up to you guys.
At the end of the day, nothing's going to get approved until
right.
we come back on Wednesday. But If we posted, nobody would
right.
go.
The other thing, just getting back, so that retaining wall has been removed?
So the bottom course of the wall is still there.
Okay. All right. So that would prevent any soil erosion during a heavy storm?
There
event?
Is erosion control yeah. installed.
Yeah,
so
but the bottom wasn't towed in.
I towed it in, basically.
Okay.
We did that.
And
last meeting.
Chuck told me
I talked about
the retaining
it.
Wall is.
It wasn't towed in when I looked at
on
it.
That side.
Yeah.
Trenton.
From
when you looked at it since
here to here.
No.
Okay. Yeah, from here to here till you get to the retaining wall that was started, it is all dug in and well installed.
But it wasn't when we went out.
Right.
There.
Right.
Okay.
He took your.
We had told him last meeting to.
Okay.
To tow
he
it.
Took your comment seriously and asked me to take a look when I was out there. And so.
Just wanted to make sure.
Yeah. So that I don't think there's an erosion risk from the site right now.
Okay.
And the nice thing with where the you can see where that wall was because there's enough of it left. I'm still a little amazed at how they got the blocks to look so clean.
Are you going to have
you know?
A plan to loosen up the soil that was underneath that wall?
So yeah, I mean the idea would be we would remove the wall. We'd remove any fill that was sort of beyond the wall, if any, and basically scrape back right at the edge, and then from the bottom of any new wall or from whatever grading we do in lieu of a wall, we essentially would taper off to the edge with fresh loam, nice organic, not just a 4-inch layer, but deep enough so that we can get good roots established and everything. If it's too hard for me to put an auger through, we'll have to rototill it or do something to loosen it up.
Okay.
Excellent.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thanks for your willing to listen to being flexible. So I think that's helpful.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Did we have a time for that meeting on Tuesday? Just the regular? Because Amy's not, she was kind of the limiting factor on that. So we could have that meeting at 5. I don't know if.
Are you available at 5?
Yeah, I can make sure.
Can
I,
you?
I honestly don't know.
Okay.
I just don't know.
We're going to have to keep that flexible.
Dave, how are you with that?
I believe I will be around on the 9th. The Thursday before till the 9th, no.
I would expect Al to be back. Didn't he say he was coming back?
I don't know where he is.
I'll pencil in 5 minutes.
Well, Anika's going to be.
She'll be back.
She'll be back. So we're going to have a few. So it seems like we have 4 or 5.
And if I can't make it, I just have a horrendous week next week. So if I can't make it, I'm comfortable going.
It's not next week.
I mean,
week
the week
after.
Oh, yeah. I should be fine then. I'm sorry. Kay. I should be fine.
All right.
So at 5 o'clock, okay.
Yeah. And you feel free if things come up and it needs to be 5:30, whether just let me know. But I'll pencil at 5 right now.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Yep. All right.
194 Van Norden Road.
Yes. I'd just like to sign that. Permit that we said everyone approved the permit last meeting, but we never signed the determination. So that's a little bit of a bookkeeping we need to do.
Oh. Remember that house we approved on South Street?
Maybe I just never did the site visit.
Maybe.
It doesn't look familiar to me.
Maybe.
I don't remember that either. So Van Norden, is this the, which one's this? Is this the this the REA, or is it the shed?
It's the shed.
The shed, okay.
Excuse me.
Can we pass something like this around, and does that even show up in the minutes?
Well, I write down that we signed this.
Okay.
No.
Remember she kept coming in and working with you?
Yeah. I recognize the address, but that looks so different.
Well, that's because it's the angle of the shot. I'm trying to take advantage of because it was listed and then sold for less. A lot less. We're continuing a certificate of compliance for Mariano Drive.
Yeah, I haven't heard from Al about that, and it's been a pretty, that guy had stopped watering last year, and Al said that's what the problem was.
Yep, that would do it.
And maybe with this kind of drought we're having here.
I don't think it's any better.
My lawn goes crunch when I walk in.
Yeah.
And then 244 R Ash Street, is that
244 Ash Street? I sent you guys some information on that. I mean, the owners, I don't understand why, even though that I guess maybe I understand in such a way. So the building inspectors went out there, and there was a little back and forth on how they needed to prepare their loading dock, and as far as having drains and whatnot. And apparently, the loading docks were built without drains in them. And they need to put in this system after the fact, which has caused a lot of a lot of problems for the owners.
Uh-huh.
But I did leave two messages; they never called me back, and I think this must be part of it. So that can actually, I'm going to actually take that off the agenda because I don't know what they're doing, and they're not talking to me. But they're not getting their occupancy or certificate of compliance until we go through this process again, but according to the building department, they still have work to do. And Jack Sullivan is the engineer on that, so I could, if you have any questions, I could email him.
Okay. Tree update on the tree policy.
Well, I had time to reflect till the last meeting. So
this is the latest, right?
Well, no. If you recall, last time we had a discussion about almost looking at it in two pieces, because there was a lot of discussion about not really being comfortable with no approval being required on anything that was within our jurisdiction. So what this does is it says, here's what you can do under certain situations within our jurisdiction, and includes some ideas that don't require approval. And at least some of the commission was uncomfortable with that. So what Chuck suggested, which I think was logical, is to say, all right, what's the tree replacement policy? Okay. And then if there's a way to add on any kind of tree cutting policy, if you look at them separately, it makes the whole thing a lot easier to get your head around, because the replacement policy by itself is pretty straightforward. If you cut down a tree, you plant a new one, at least whatever we said, you know, 2-inch diameter or whatever it was, remember?
Mm-hmm.
So I haven't rewritten anything. It's just a really busy time at work for me. So maybe here's what I would propose. Let me rewrite a tree replacement policy. I'll take what's in here and say our tree replacement policy is, in the event that you have approval from the Reading Conservation Commission to cut down a tree within its jurisdiction, here is what you need to do in order of replacements. 2-inch diameter and native species from the website. And let's get that done. And then live with that for a while. And if we think a year from now we need something that allows people more latitude on cutting, then we can revisit it. So that's what I would propose.
Are we, I hate to harp on this again, but are we also allowing not just replacement with another tree, but with shrubs where it makes sense.
Yes.
Okay. A good example of that was, remember, Bob?
I'm not confused about that.
Okay.
I'm confused about the replacement versus cutting issue. What qualifies in your mind as cutting?
So we said, for example, if you had...
Isn't a replacement cutting? I mean, if you're getting rid of something.
No. A replacement is once it's been cut, what is it
you're going to do?
So our policy is after they've come to us and we've...
Yes.
Whatever has occurred for, you know, it comes to us, we say, yes, this tree can go.
Mm-hmm.
We now have some sort of policy that says what's going to go back in its place.
Yes.
All right. I'm fine with that then. I didn't quite understand.
Now, I'm a little sketchy on if you're going to take down a 75-foot oak tree with a drip edge of 100 feet, is it okay to put a new blueberry bush in its place?
Well, I mean, that's why we have case-by-case basis. Yeah, there are cases where it could be.
Well, let me answer that, and I'll go back to Robert Moses. I forget where it was, but there were all these very, very large trees encroaching upon his back area. It doesn't matter
that
what it was.
The bridge driveway.
Right, oh yeah. And if you're going to replace it with a really fast growing tree, you're just still going to have the problem.
Mm-hmm.
So in that case, you know, maybe you put in, you know, a nice buffer of, you know, high bush blueberry.
So I think that's... Yeah.
That type of thing where, you know, you're trying to control, trying to not get into that same kind of situation, but also to provide habitat.
So, and that's kind of where I thought we were going with this tree policy. When someone comes to us with a permit, the commission opens the policy up and it says, oh, you're taking down a oak tree that's, you know, got a DBH of 24. And then you just use that chart, and it says your options are three, so we can be consistent, three native trees or seven shrubs. And I thought that's what we were working on.
So how
they still always have to come to us,
yeah.
But we're able to be consistent because we have this chart to you know, check off things.
And so I agree with that. I think, though, the one thing I would just add about the cutting aspect, though, is because... All this all started when somebody pointed out to us, you know, somebody in the public had a comment on a tree that they didn't think should be removed. And so whether or not we have some sort of requirement, I'm totally in agreement that we always want them to come to us. If it's in our jurisdiction, we want them to come to us. We don't want a policy saying, just go ahead and do whatever you want.
Well, I'm just saying there shouldn't be a cutting side to this. This should just be a replacement.
But should there be an aspect of this, a side of this? You know, we've recently started saying, well, we want a letter from an arborist saying why this tree should come down.
Mm-hmm.
I guess is where I don't think we necessarily need to have this matrix of if it's cut in this zone and this zone, this is what you should be getting. I don't think that's what we want part of it, but do we want part of this from the cutting aspect? This is what the commission is looking for. If you're going to come in and cut down and propose removing a tree,
but if you're asking for an arborist all the time, you know, not all of them are compromised, so they're going to say it's a healthy tree.
We get a lot of that.
If it's 50 feet away, maybe. If it's in the wetland, if it's in the 25-foot buffer, should it be removed if an arborist is saying this one's not compromised and it's not a safety hazard? I guess that's where I'm coming from. That's kind of where this all started. Was somebody looked at it? Somebody in the public made a comment that people are just saying, I want to cut this down. Safety. And we said, well, that's a good point. We want to see that someone, some professional, that says
yes, this is a safety issue, or yes, this is dying, or yes, this is... And I guess the cutting aspect that I think should be in there should also be some sort of policy on what qualifies the removal of a tree, what we want to see with a proposed removal of a tree.
So I think that makes sense, but I think that's where we got in trouble before, is we tried to do too much
mm-hmm.
at once. So that's why I recommended scaling back the policy to, once we've agreed to let a tree be removed, this is what you do to replace it. So, and I think maybe, Chuck, when you say a grid, are you saying like for every foot of diameter of a tree, add two more replacement trees, or
well, there's a chart. Why don't I send you this chart that I know from another town?
Okay.
And you can look at it.
Okay.
And it does have shrubs on it, so it might be very helpful.
Okay.
And it does actually mention what the commission might like to see, such as a letter from an arborist. They could they could ask for that. You don't have to come in with one, but expect it, you know, or understand that it could
be
asked for. Yeah, it might give you a big... And I kind of did that. You weren't on the committee back then.
Okay.
I mean, I really...
Did that town that we gave...
This is pretty much the same town that I sent all the information in the first place from. It's not my town. But,
yeah. So now you get...
So
my,
you,
I
but then you guys... Then somehow it went into this other zone. But it's...
Got it.
Really, we're just looking to
say... Yeah, no, that's fine.
Hey, you know, 24-inch tree... That's five replacement plants. You know, unless there's some sort of density problem in the yard and it won't work,
yeah.
So then you give yourself that caveat
to
comes back to the commission to make the final decision.
Yep. That's fine.
Okay. So I'll send that to you.
Okay. And then Mike, to your point, maybe the next thing we tackle is, all right, should we... If that doesn't address it, then here are the other...
So you're saying if it's a healthy tree in the wetland and the 25 and no disturbance, no vegetation clearing, then it shouldn't be removed. We would deny.
Well, I don't want a homeowner coming to us and saying, "Oh, well, I'm going to just take this out." If it's a safety issue, if there's
mm-hmm.
if they can show that it's fine, and from a professional, an arborist can tell us that, then I'm willing to accept that. But a homeowner should not be coming in and saying, this is within the 25-foot zone, I want to take this sucker out.
I mean, so can we, would you guys accept a qualified professional, such as someone who's had many years in the tree industry or something like that?
Correct, yes.
So he isn't an arborist?
Yeah.
Or she isn't an arborist. Okay, fine. To make sure, so qualified professionals.
We have a tree warden in town. He won't.
Yeah, but he's not gonna. That's for the town trees, right?
Okay.
He's not gonna go and do each homeowner.
So the only thing I'll say,
you know, one of the things that is an example, they didn't bring it up, but certainly they mentioned it when we did our site visit, that multi-trunked Norway maple that's on the side of their house. You know, that's leaning like this, that's leaning towards the house. And she said it twice tonight, you know, when it snows and it gets real heavy. You know, I'm looking at that and thinking, you know, one of those heavy, heavy, wet snowstorms, that's going into their house.
And typically what we've been requiring lately, it wasn't until we started this process, but what we've been requiring lately, if it's in the zone, we're completely amenable for that coming down, as long as a professional says, yeah, look, it's leaning, it's, you know, we would recommend that this comes down. There's no other good solution here.
Yeah.
You guys bring up something that I've been thinking about is those pesky allopathic vegetation, Norway maples.
Oh.
You know, did you know what it was?
That's getting used in a Scrabble game. Don't you know
yes.
that?
I gotta get the right stuff. I love it.
I'm using that.
Junipers
yeah.
do that too.
What?
Junipers do that too.
Would we be opposed to people taking them out?
Yes. Would we be opposed? What do you mean? Should they bypass the permit process?
No, they always come in.
No, not necessarily.
If they
but
come before us.
But, you know, you'll see them. They were planted. They were used pretty heavily, I don't know, in the 50s, 60s as tree
yeah.
plantings.
Yeah.
And they do wipe out lots of native stuff. And they look pretty healthy. Would we be opposed to taking them?
Well, you'd give it, you know, on the scale, you would allow more of those to come down, but I still believe there should be some
replacement.
And do a replacement
with
yeah.
native, but... Okay.
No, I think that, I mean, if it was a healthy 36-inch Norway maple, 85 feet from the house, and there's no way it would hit the house if it fell over, but, you know, nothing's growing around it except for grass. And the guy says, look, I gotta get this out of here because I want a lawn or something. There's no other you might say, yeah, let's take that down because we understand what's happening with that root system.
I have a good example. I have these Norway maples along a bank.
Denied.
And one night I said, oh my God, George, did you feel that? It was like a, because what? I went outside and I looked. Then I saw it, a whole part of the tree. And it looked healthy, and it just came crashing and missed everything.
Yeah, they don't have a taproot. It was Norway's. Yeah.
So the only other thing I'd say on the arborist is they're the same person that's going to get paid when the tree comes down, right?
We've had this discussion, though.
I know, but that's up to us. We need to educate ourselves. We're the final word on that. And usually... So that's balanced off by someone who continually comes to the Conservation Commission.
Yeah.
So they're not going to, they have to maintain their reputation.
I agree with that. So I guess the only thing I thought of is ask them to represent it in a standard way that says maybe in writing, I believe this tree is
on his letter,
in imminent danger of falling or is has a 50% chance of falling within 2 years on the property or something. Something that says, something for us to be able to say, right, that's reasonable. Because I recall a couple of meetings where, it was even the meeting I came to before I was on the commission, where you basically had someone stand up and say, yeah, this could fall on the house. And, you know, any tree can fall.
There's been someone like on Haverhill Street that were pretty far from the house, but big.
Yeah.
A huge one in the middle of the yard, for instance. And it could have fallen on the house, but it was very healthy.
Yeah.
And it was just that, you know, wind gust scare.
Yeah.
That went through
town. I have that in my backyard, and it's, there's no wetland, so there's no issue, but I would have to convince my neighbor. But anyway, all right, so why don't I take a crack at that once you send that to me, Chuck?
Okay.
Yep.
And
awesome.
I might just do it myself instead of reconvening.
We had a meeting, when was it? Last Tuesday?
We had a meeting?
Well, there was a meeting that I was invited to, and a lot of other volunteer folks throughout the town. And it was the selectmen and CPDC about a zoning charrette. Well, basically, When I think of a charrette is when, you know, you get together with designers and you come up with ideas. It basically was talking about rezoning a section of Main Street from Haven Street down down.
South?
Yeah, south. Yes, south. And it was to put it into what's called a 40R zone. And apparently, when you do that, you can get it's a way for the state to encourage more housing because I guess there is a dearth of housing in throughout the state. It allows you to do mixed use, like for instance, in the downtown here on Haven Street. We have, you know, where the old Atlantic used to be, we've got, you know, businesses, commercial businesses on the first floor, and then we have mixed housing on the upper floors. So that's kind of what they're thinking about with this 40R, just expanding it basically down. And one thing that did come up, and there were a lot of questions, they still can put in 40B. It doesn't prevent it. That one was kind of, one person said one thing, another person said another thing, but they can still put in a 40B. And I thought it was kind of a great idea. They get, I guess for the zone, a section of zone, they get one lump sum of $350,000, and then every time a building permit comes in for a residential unit, they get $3,000. So it's also, you know, kind of a win-win situation for the town as well, from a fiscal standpoint.
It was also discussed that there was this town and the Main Street area had a pretty severe parking problem. Most of the people that came believed that, but there was some charts provided by the town and by the planning office showing that there was a lot of parking around town and around that corridor of Main Street, but it wasn't being used to the best way it could be, because a restaurant would have it that fills up at 6 o'clock, but all day long the store across the street has no parking, but there's a whole empty parking lot, you know, two lanes away. So they're frustrated by this, but they want to work on that to try to open up these areas and encourage people to maybe share is not the word, but to allow different parking for different times throughout the town, because it's needed.
One of the developers, pointed out that it's a great idea, but if you look at the lots are too small to provide, you know, that kind of density, you know, with something on the first floor, and then, you know, I don't think it's the residential components, the commercial, and that the lots are just so narrow, and that's been a frustration of them.
Was his argument that building height should increase? Or he just thought that?
No, I didn't hear that. That didn't come into that discussion. The other thing I was thinking is, you know, when you go this way, it's all a residential zone, and you can't have any kind of commercial in a residential zone. And I was thinking, well, why wouldn't they have expanded that 40R and tried
that
to?
That won't be included in it?
No. No. Yeah, I thought it was pretty narrow. I would have added further
back, yeah.
Yeah, further back, but what do I know? It was interesting. It was pretty interesting. But I think it was really
a lot of, yeah, there was a lot of thought put into that. You could tell that they had,
it was well done.
Really thought
Gene,
about every
Gene did a really good job answering questions, mm-hmm. I thought, and it was really to educate us so that we know what kind of what's going on. But truthfully, there's not much doing with wetlands. And
yeah, that mixed use is very interesting.
Yep.
Good stuff. I hope it energizes a lot of business owners downtown if it goes through. So, yeah, it was good. They fed us. That was nice.
Another item I'd like to bring up, we're going to have a time for Jamie Mohn, August 8th, which is a Monday evening. I haven't, like, show of hands of who prefer what, Bunratty's versus Bertucci's.
I'm not going to be in town that day.
Okay.
Either one's fine with me.
Does Jamie have a preference?
You know, those are the two things he came up with. I said, you know, you got any suggestions?
He's only interested in which place serves Brunswick stew?
Neither.
Oh, well,
what's
then it
Brunswick
probably doesn't
stew?
Matter to him.
Neither. It's August 8th.
Yeah, it's a Monday. Anywhere from 6:30 to 7:00, I was thinking. So who's available, I guess?
I'll be there.
All right.
Yeah, I think I can go.
That day, I actually have a meeting in Arlington, so I can't make it.
Yep. Dave, you're not, you can't.
I'll be out of town until Tuesday, during the day.
And which one did you decide on?
We do a site visit in, on Salem Street.
Bunratty's or Pertucci's?
Doesn't really matter. I'm not crazy. Well, this is live TV. I don't, I'm not going to show any preference.
I don't have a preference.
Okay, I'll let you decide that off air.
And Mike, no, Will Finch will be joining us. All right. One other item. Chuck got a call, or I guess this entity has been looking to come into Reading for the last 3 years. It's called Go Ape, and it's basically, you know, those rope courses.
Oh, yeah.
Like monkey trunks. Have you ever seen those? You know. Yeah, and so they were looking at, well, Chuck and I talked about, you know, some places, maybe conservation land use as passive recreation. And there was a one area off of Birch Meadow Drive called Higgins Conservation Land, set up, I think, in 1976. It's near that elementary school. What I liked about it is there's, with those places, you need parking. What I liked about that area is that, you know, you've got a kind of a live audience. That's kind of the audience you want to gear your business towards, you know, the young people.
Can you tell me a little more, like, what exactly it is that they do?
They have these platforms on trees, and you have, like, maybe a ladder, rope ladder, going from tree.
Like a bridge?
Yep. And you, you know, walk along that, and it's to build up confidence, teamwork.
Are they up in the canopy of the trees or down low?
They're not in the canopy, but they're halfway. They're up pretty high. I would say they could be up anywhere from 10 to 20 feet.
So it's like a rope walk.
Yeah.
Between the tree.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And some, you know, it may be a zip line, you know, but you got to have a hill. You got to have a pretty good hill to do a zip line.
Or a tall tree.
Yeah. Yeah. And then we were talking about the town forest near the compost area on the left. As you're going in, the compost is here and the road is here. There's another road that kind of loops around, and there's some really tall trees in there. But what I liked about that, it didn't have much of an understory, but there are a couple isolated wetlands, you know, in that area.
And what about Bear Meadow near, like, Matera, like at the top of the hill there?
Yeah, I actually mentioned that too, but
I don't think the parking is,
that would really change.
What's the parking at Town Forest though?
You park along Stroud Avenue or in the
compost
area?
In the
compost
area, there's plenty of areas there. This is so preliminary right now,
yeah.
That I mean, I don't even think the town offices have got together or even got a presentation. It was more or less, I just got a tap on my shoulder from John Fudo, and he said, what do I think about it? And I thought it was a great idea because, you know, if you, you know, when we were young, we would go out in the woods, but I hear so many stories now that no one's allowed in the woods. And this is maybe one of those more modern ways to enjoy the forest that, you know, we're not thinking of. So anyways, it's no sense to set aside land and not use it. So if we could find a spot, I thought it would have been great. And so we're into at least hearing the monkey, the Go Ape people come down and talk. And I think people are starting to talk around. I talked to John Recreation, he brought it to me. We mentioned it at the charrette to a couple of selectmen. They thought it was a great idea, but they knew about it already also. And I talked to Kim Honischlager about, I actually think I said that correctly.
I think you
not
did.
Sure.
Who's that?
Will Finch's wife.
Yeah, but she's on the Trails Committee,
yep.
And she's an you know, all about town forests, all about trails committee, so she didn't get
her. Does she do our GIS?
She does our GIS quite well. And she provides maps and stuff like that for the town, does a lot of great presentations. She's like behind the scenes on a lot of the stuff that the town presents. And she thought it was, you know, an interesting concept, and was willing to listen to the presentation. And I also talked to Bob Keating about that, and he thought it was a great idea. His concern was what do the fasteners look like? So everyone, you know, again, there was no automatic, no, won't happen, there's going to be all these issues, it's going to be a lot to overcome. We didn't hear that. So I think it's going to move forward. I don't know what the time frame is, though.
Is it a for-profit company?
Yeah.
Yes.
So the only thing I would tell you, we went to the Amazon, and we went through some big ones, way up in the canopy of the rainforest.
I've done it in Costa Rica.
My only worry is, it's twofold, and it's around liability. So one is, can these guys get insurance? Because it's going to be hard to get an insurance company to give you liability protection.
Well, they have a operation up and running in Connecticut right now. So we're not the first.
Okay.
I don't know if there's more than that one.
And then the part two is, does the town need any sort of insurance if we let them do this?
Well, thank God that's not our problem.
Yeah.
I mean, I know, but it's just something to...
We can approve it and then let the selectmen worry about that part. And they'd probably put it on to town council, I suspect.
Yep.
And would they, so how do they make money? Do they...
They charge
admission.
Yeah. Charge admission.
You've gone up Route 1 just up past the Kittery Trading Post. There's one on the right-hand side.
Okay.
We're in Route 1 up in Maine.
Oh, right there.
That's
I don't
Kittery.
Go up that way. I usually go right to the Kittery Trading Post. I never go any further.
Tamworth on Route 16.
Yeah.
Monkey Trunks.
I can tell you, just throw out one thing. I know that in the
there's one at Cranmore.
They had a non-profit organization that ran an area that was called Camp 40 Acres. It was something that was used extensively by the youth of Wilmington for school projects and summer projects and camps and things like that. And they had a certified ropes course that was at Camp 40 Acres that was rented out by the Everett Police Department for a youth program that they were doing. They had certified ropes instructors and safety people there. Kid fell down from one of them, broke his neck. Sued Camp 40 Acres. Camp 40 Acres is now closed because the insurance company settled with the person that broke their neck, even though they signed away liability to everyone. They sued, the insurance company settled with the kid that broke his neck, and the insurance company canceled their liability insurance. It's closed. So now all the kids that abused that for, you know, they did things on vernal pools and nature walks and nature identification for years. It was intimately tied with the school and also summer programs. Now it's gone. It's closed.
Mm.
So
things like that are a shame, but
it is.
If they don't have it, it's not going to get used anyways.
No.
So I would rather see something.
Try
you don't want to see.
Yeah.
Try.
Yeah. I would love to see it get that get done, but I would be real careful about the liability part of it. Because you don't want to put that kind of infrastructure together and then you go a year, 2 years down the road and then all of a sudden it's gone.
Well, it's just something to think about as they're beginning to talk about it.
All right.
That's all.
So they come to us not because of buffer zone but because
if it was on our
conservation
land.
Yeah.
That we manage. Now, we don't manage the town forest.
We don't.
No. But it would be if it was in our buffers.
Yeah. I mean, we would have a say with the isolated wetlands. What? Huh?
We don't manage town forest?
No.
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 Town forest committee.
What was the Boy Scout project that came to us?
It was closed.
The resource area.
Right, sorry.
Close.
Go ahead.
It was in that jurisdiction.
All right.
Yeah, that's why. It's a little confusing. I don't know all of our conservation lands. I have to be honest with you. Okay. Minutes for approval.
I was technically challenged, and I sent you what I thought was track changes, but it apparently stopped tracking the changes.
Did it just accept them all?
I did something wrong. I apologize.
Did you get them?
I did, and this is what you sent me.
What you got me was post changes.
Okay.
You can't tell what I changed, which is not helpful to you. The one thing, I think everything was minor. What I'll say is just one thing is I abstained on Salem Street last time. 218 Salem Street. So it said 6-0 approved. It was actually 5-0-1.
Right,
because
you couldn't understand.
I just didn't.
Yeah.
Just
all
right,
so you changed that because I see that right here.
Yeah, so that's the only thing that I would ask that you change. The other changes are in there, you just don't know that I changed them.
Did anybody else have changes?
Becky had changes, but she didn't have track changes.
I read them, and truthfully, I'm glad you caught that, but I didn't. Yeah, I would have changed a few words.
This computer's available for, you know.
All right, then I'll come in.
If you want to come in and, you know.
This right up here, right?
You don't even have to, Anaj, just walk in and start using it. All
right.
That's it. I mean, it would be better if I could set you up here. So if you gave me some notice, that would be fine. But this computer is available for during the day.
All
right.
I could do that.
So with that one change that we know about, and the other ones, I guess, were typos. And
that was minor stuff.
Yeah.
So I'm fine.
Do you want to accept the minutes?
Make a motion to accept the minutes as modified.
Dave seconded. All those in favor? Do we have any bills? None.
Yeah, but I have two things. The three things. No, two things. This one's done. So, 14 Strawberry Hill Lane. I was contacted by an attorney, Favaloro.
Is that one of these things there?
No, this is just a thing that I'm just going to bring up tonight, just to take it off the table. It's very, very minor. Attorney Favaloro contacted me, and he said that site has been sold to someone else, but they discovered after the fact that there was a bond on the site. And he would like the commission to approve a letter that he sent to me that says, essentially, although that Mona D'Angelo sent us the bond and it's in her name, when it's returned, it needs to go back to CNF Properties, the LLC company that bought the land. And so I have that paper from the attorney, and he just wants to know that we approved to do that. You'd like to read it, it's right here.
So my understanding is the bond was there to ensure that there's some things that still need to be.
Which one's 14 Strawberry?
It's the hard-packed dirt lot that was grubbed, but then not developed.
Next to the vernal pool.
This one. Wait, so when was this sold?
It was sold a month ago.
Oh, I did not realize.
I saw it listed.
So, the bond's just being transferred from...
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, it's being transferred. We're not
it
releasing
says,
it.
The bond standing in the name of Mona D'Angelo will be designated as standing in the name of CF Properties Advancements LLC.
So when it's released, it goes to them
yep.
and not to...
Got it, yeah.
Do I hear a motion?
I'll make a motion to approve. To approve.
And he says that it's going to be... released to CNF Properties Advancement.
So we're making a motion to approve the reassignment of the bond on that property, the 14
Strawberry.
Property.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Mike.
400.
He's whoever the previous owner was, she was in on this conversation. Was this?
Well, she sold the property. She sold.
She sold the property.
Yes, but did she sell?
This right after we approved it.
No comment.
I guess I know it's after I.
I understand there may be some minor changes to the plan, because what was going out there was a, I don't know what they're called. Like, they spanned a great distance. Like, there was no there were no walls holding things up, and they don't want to build it that way.
But they had put in a wall down closer to the property line.
He's talking about the structure.
No, I'm talking about the span of inside the building. So they might be changing the footprint a little bit.
Oh.
So I was asked some questions about that. The retaining wall, they knew that was not.
It wasn't on the plan.
Walked through it. These are people that bought this, although I don't recognize the name. I think the people that I know bought it. They work in town a lot. You know, I truly believe it will be finished within a year. So that's good for us.
That's a good point.
Hopefully.
If it actually expired, we could have gotten a vernal pool back.
No. It's on the other property.
But what is?
The vernal pool.
Yeah, but if the notice of intent expires, we at that point we could have gone back and to try to prove that it's a vernal pool again.
Well, in our regulations, if it's suspected as a vernal pool, we hold it the same, standards.
So,
but this one went to court, I believe, and they were able to.
Yes. So if we don't need to get into this now. I guess my thought was if we couldn't change it now because there was a decision already made based on a letter changing, but you can always go back and make it a vernal pool again if you prove that it is a vernal pool. But it would have done nothing for a permit that was already approved. Right? Am I wrong there?
So I don't think there's any. I do not. I think that the only thing that you've done when you decertify a vernal pool is for that moment in time, it's been decertified. If you went out the next day and filled out your form and recertified it, it's certified again. It's not a 3-year ruling or anything like that. So anytime that someone else moves into that neighborhood and wants to certify that as a vernal pool, they absolutely can. And if it, you know, although we've already given the order of conditions, we couldn't change this project. But, you know, when you really think about it, I mean, there has to be a way to permit a house close enough to a vernal pool with conditions on it that allows everybody to kind of share the space. So, now what is that distance? It's not 1,000 feet, but does it need to be 100 feet? Or, you know, what's forested already? There's nothing forested on this lot anymore.
But if we went and certified that vernal pool,
mm-hmm.
that project's going on no matter what.
Right. There is an NOI in place. I mean, order of conditions.
Order of conditions.
In effect.
Yeah.
Until
next.
That's I guess what I'm saying.
Until next March or so, right? Something like that.
A year, yeah. I think it was it?
Maybe it was May.
April it was.
May.
It didn't
yeah.
seem that long.
Yeah.
If it expires and it gets certified, then a new project has to come before us, and at that point.
Right, it's a total start over.
Exactly.
Yeah,
well,
they can start the construction
I did warn
under this order of conditions.
The new property owners that they must start this. It's if they come back in a year with an empty lot, it's going to be a very tough sell to the commission.
Well, they barely got it through this time.
And I think they're very well aware of that.
So
the only other thing wanted to say, it has nothing to do with the vernal pool. It's actually going on to my last item. You guys know
that's
the
fine.
VP?
Good.
Okay. The Trails Committee is coming in at our next meeting to request a 5-year extension for their townwide trails maintenance permit. And I would just say that if you feel there's something that needs to be changed, you know, here we're in this time to think about these things. And we
do
can discuss
we have,
it at the next meeting.
Do we have their trail maintenance? I'm not aware of it. Is it on the website?
Their permit?
What they're proposing for trail maintenance? They want an extension?
So they want an extension of a townwide, I forget the name of this, but it's a continuing permit. So the town sewage and water runs on.
It's a maintenance plan?
No, so that we're approving projects in advance of them happening under certain conditions. And then they have to come in and talk to us about them.
Okay.
Are we having any issues currently with the 5-year with the current?
I think the only issue we would have with this, I think it's a very well-run group. My only issue, and I kind of thought about this, well, I think if the current people that were on the Trails Committee changed drastically, then it would be tougher for us because they're really a bunch of seasoned people that keep a lot of the trails here in town to DCR standards. And they seem to care, and they have their little spot underneath the Matera cabin for their little hangout, and they keep their parts and tools and whatnot, and they work on the trails. And the trails are nice, and when something's recognized as being wrong, like there's a tree down or something like that, it's removed immediately. But this is more or less them developing more trails, and they want to, like the scouts that come in, they use this permit to build their own trails. So it's part of that permit, so they don't have to go through all the expense and all the time and filling out paperwork, but they still have to present it to the commission and have, you know, a quarter of the paperwork needed. But I would say that I don't see any problem, but I would if a new group came in.
So even if a new group came in, they still have to come to us. We're still going to know that it's happening. We can still provide our feedback as to what needs to improve if this new group is all of a sudden not.
That's exactly what my problem is.
Oh.
And I don't think a new group's coming in. But
yeah.
What the problem is when they think that they have a permit to do this stuff, yet they don't understand what they're supposed to do inside the permit. But this group knows this, and a different group may not know that, and they'll just think, oh, you have a permit to do all this stuff, we'll just
so they would do it without notification,
without going through the correct process. So you know, you can, these maintenance permits can be 5 years, so that's not an issue. And it's really about if any of these things that you've had, you thought that they went somewhere where they weren't supposed to, there's too many of them, you know, the town forest is turning into a freeway, you know, whatever. Those are the kind of things that...
What if you ask them in their renewed plan to notify Conservation Commission in the event there is a change, or any time there's a change in the officers of the organization, as a way to at least notify us that we need to talk to them and let them know what rules they are supposed to be operating under?
That could be a new condition that's good, yeah. It's called a general permit. You ever heard of these? Some of the towns do these for the roads and general maintenance, but it's not identified. Yeah, we have two with the town. So they can't get a permit every time a tree comes down, so they have to get a permit in advance, you know, unexpected things that need to happen immediately. so.
Yeah,
I would still make the permit conditional on if there was a change in leadership in the trail committee, that that person would then be provided a document as to what the protocol would be for new projects and anything moving forward.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of easy to do.
Yeah. I'm thinking this group's going to be around for another bunch of years. I mean, Will Finch is part of this group. Kim, you know, they're all the same people.
That's
really.
Fine. I think that might be a way to, even if it doesn't change in the next 5 years, then it's in there the next time. And,
mm-hmm.
You know.
I mean, I think it takes us paying attention. I mean, adding
yeah.
another line to a permit that they're not going to read and just think that, oh, we've got a permit,
mm.
may not. Is probably
but,
not going to solve
but at
the
least
problem.
If there's an officer election, maybe say, oh, you know what? We're supposed to tell Conservation Commission.
Yeah.
That's all.
Okay. Anything else on the agenda we need to bring up?
I think I'm finished. I'm finished.
Okay.
Nope.
So, what were these other things that were added to our...
what do we have there?
116 Van Orden?
Commercial building.
Just showing you that they're FYI and.
And then what about this
overhead garage doors?
Notes to commission. Is that something we're supposed to?
Yeah, didn't you like that? I thought I added the notes to the commission. I even gave you the cheat sheet on where to look up. So we're gonna have this come in. So let's get back to this. This was about 244 AR. Ash Street, where I just told you that they're not getting their certificate
yeah.
of compliance, and
yeah,
that
yeah.
was the reason. That's what the commission, that's what the building inspector wants them to do. Okay.
No.
So that's why I provided that to you. And we're having a notice of intent for Eaton and Lakeview, and I received that already, and it's going to be presented by Bill Manuel. And there's going to be a big development down in that area. But
oh,
it's previously disturbed. So, but is even in the riverfront. So the conversation with Bill Manuel was there was a case about some other section, I guess it was across the street, where they said that's a man-made canal. And I think Bill Heck talked about this a lot, and Bill Manuel wants to say, although this wasn't the site they were talking about, what they're talking about and what they described is exactly what's happening here on his site. So he's asking you, and he's going to go through the motions of saying that this area is also a canal. I think the differences are very minor, because that previously disturbed area is on Lakeview is pretty clear, and I think that's more than enough than they what they need to work with. But I think there's a house lot involved too that has lawn and some trees, and that may be what the problem is back in that area. But it's pretty close, so we need to see the plans and look at that. But I looked through our regulations in the Wetlands Protection Act, and I wrote down all the stuff about the riverfront, so you might have an easier time looking things up.
So that was where we changed the bylaws to include canal in riverfront, right?
Yeah. And he mentioned that too.
Okay.
He said we've already sidestepped that by adding that in there. So, and you know, if you want to.
How are we gonna keep this?
Read some good stuff about the riverfront.
You.
There you go. What is it? Just four or five things.
Okay.
That's it. The sidewalks are working good. And was there any? And was there any feedback from how we're doing the minutes that needs to be changed? I mean, I would rather have more people chime in. At least correct what you think you said on each agenda item would be great. So
I thought the minutes were good. Nice, concise, to the point.
Yeah, I thought they were good too. I apologize about the track changes. I just...
Did you do that at work?
I did, and I think, you know what it is? I I was doing it fast. I made my changes and it showed all the track changes. And then I think I just hit forward by email without saving it. And I think I have to save it in order for the track changes to be saved. Because it went and then you got it and the changes took effect. So I think I needed to save it.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times I'll do that. I'll edit a document, send it back to whoever sent it to me. Or I'll write a document, I'll write a letter, and I'll email it to somebody. I won't even save it. So I think that's what I did wrong. I just skipped that step because that's what I normally do, and I don't usually do track changes. So I just needed to be more careful. So that won't be a problem going forward.
That's good.
So do you want what I captured tonight? Which
yes.
is virtually impossible to read, but I wrote 4-0 pretty clearly.
I don't Mike's, though. Makes me feel bad about my handwriting.
Well, don't worry, you'll feel good after you see mine. So
you need to read it, right?
This is I could read this from across the room, man. This is good stuff.
This is like, well, I'll wait till after we close the meeting.
This is
I tell you my laundry story.
Okay. No.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor.
Woohoo.